Please get ready for a dictation of transcription number 61 and part of 62 from Sir Kailash Chandra magazine. 5 seconds. Start. The President's address makes mention of the code of discipline and the happy industrial relations which are developing in the country. This code of discipline is a very good thing, but I am sorry to say that the success claimed for it has not come as yet. The employers in the country have not accepted this code of discipline in its spirit. They have not accepted it voluntarily. They have not shown by their conduct that they understand and appreciate the spirit of the code of discipline, and something will have to be done about it. The code of discipline can bring about better harmonious relations. It can bring about better industrial relations, and it can create conditions in which the industrial production in the country will go up by leaps and bounds. Industrialists in the private sector and some of the bureaucrats in the public sector do not accept this code of discipline, and unless the Ministry of Labour does something drastic about it, unless the Ministry of Labour does something which would make the non-observance of this code on the part of the employers a penal offence, I'm afraid the spirit of the code would be defeated. The Ministry of Labour has done well in bringing forward a code of efficiency and welfare. There is as yet not enough agreement on that code even from the labour's point of view. But I am sure efforts to further the acceptance of this code of efficiency and welfare will be continued, and if that is done, it will be a great help to industrial production in the country. In the matter of the bonus commission, sir, the progress made has been disappointing. It was as early as January 1961 that the Honorable Labour Minister announced the appointment of the commission. The progress made in respect of the bonus commission during the last 14 months has been that its terms of reference have been settled and its constitution has been agreed upon. That, I am afraid, is very slow speed in the direction of the solution of a problem whose solution is so very important. The President has correctly mentioned the great objective of securing workers' participation in the management and the establishing of joint management councils. But the most important thing is that the gains or the profits should be shared by the toilers. A share of the produce of their toil should come back to those who toil. The acceptance of profit sharing is an old thing. It was accepted by those responsible for the industrial truce 14 years back. But we are yet to evolve a satisfactory formula. The full bench formula of the Labour Appellate Tribunal, repeatedly approved and endorsed by the orthodox judges of the Supreme Court, is no solution of the problem. It just denies the workers their due share in the profits. It was because of this peculiar situation that the need of appointment of the bonus commission was accepted by all parties. But what we now find is that it has taken them 14 months to decide the terms of reference of the commission, and I do not know when we can expect its report. The members of the bonus commission should be directed by the government to find an early solution to this important problem. Similarly, I must point out that the delay in the matter of evolving a consolidated scheme of social security for industrial workers is a dangerous thing. We have today a number of social security schemes, but none of them looks after the workers in his old age. The government of Uttar Pradesh made a provision that the discharge of workers because of ill health or old age should be treated as retrenchment. But we have now the verdict of the High Court of Allahabad that this cannot be done. The result is that while workers in industrial establishments today are covered against the risk of ill health, there is no insurance against the risk of old age. There is no scheme of gratuity which the industry has to follow. There is no old age pension scheme which the industries in the country have to adhere to. The result is that there is a big gap or disparity in the lives of the workers who are in employment and those who are out of it, particularly those who are thrown out of employment because of old age or continued ill health. Therefore, something should be done about it as soon as possible, and there should be some sort of a scheme to see that the worker, after meritorious service to the industry, got at least the equivalent of a retrenchment relief when he retired due to old age or continued ill health. That is a pressing problem. We know that in Kanpur, industrialists have adopted the practice of terminating the employment of workers merely by giving them 12 days notice. The worker is told that he has been found to be unfit. I would like briefly to give the background under which this bill has been brought forward by the government. The House is aware that this institution has been in existence now for nearly half a century. It was established in 1910, and since then it has rendered very valuable service for the promotion of Hindi, and through holding various conferences, it focused the attention of the country to the great importance of Hindi as a national language. The institution has rendered valuable service in various other ways also. It has been conducting examinations. It has also been affiliating institutions which are doing similar kind of work in the field of Hindi, and it has branches in various parts of the country. The institution has also built up a library which probably contains almost all the books which have been published in Hindi so far, and it has a valuable collection of manuscripts. I understand that it is one of the best in the whole country. It conducts various examinations, and these examinations have been recognized by the government. It has also on its rolls a large number of members. Some differences have arisen among the members, and the activities of the institution have been paralyzed. After the declaration of Hindi as the official language, it was thought by the Sammelan that it was necessary to amend its constitution. Therefore, at the Hyderabad session of the Sammelan, held in March 1949, a resolution was passed for the amendment of the constitution, and a committee of 21 members was appointed to frame the rules and place its recommendations before a special session of the Sammelan to be held at Patna. This committee did prepare a draft constitution for the Sammelan, and it was placed before the Patna session of the Sammelan. But unfortunately, at this session, differences arose among the members, and after a good deal of discussion, it was decided ultimately to entrust the framing of the constitution to a committee of 11 persons with this proviso that a constitution signed by 8 members shall be deemed to be approved by the General Session of the Sammelan. This committee prepared a constitution and it was considered by the session of the committee held in December. At this session, differences arose among the members and the Sammelan was not able to hold its session. Stop.